Today's speaker is Dr. S V Kulkarni. He is MD, FICP, FACP, FDA, Navi Mumbai. Dr. Kulkarni have a rich experience of more than 40 years. He did his MBBS MD from Miraj in 1982. He is a visiting faculty in GMC Miraj as well as D.Y. Patil Medical College, Nehru, and also ITM. He is also an esteemed member of Indian College of Physicians, ICP. He is the organizing secretary for MAPCON 2002, 2019, and EPICON 2007 at Goa. The most important part is he is a very much a smart computer savvy, and he is pioneer in medical IT as well as a computer and smartphone technology especially. And recent he has publication is also there in many big journals as well as in renowned textbook also. So we keep this privilege to hand over today's session to Dr. S V Kulkarni. Sir, request to please start the meeting, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Vinod. Thank you, Sanjay, for this wonderful opportunity in hosting this webinar. I got certain things to disclaim as well as support and contents. You have given us an unconditioned academic grants from PRECIA. In this presentation, we will not like to discuss any controversial issues. Maybe whether it is a biological warfare or not, or what are the over-the-web alternative treatment options, whether Haldi is better or a convalescent serum. And neither we are going to talk about the government policies unless they have been accepted and published by WHO, ICMR, and ministers. So today's focus is on scientific data, the presentation method of this deadly disease, what are the options of patient care.
Dr. Kulkarni, sorry to halt you. This presentation is getting recorded for the benefit of others. Aap thoda sa piche ho jaiye ya computer screen aage aaiye. Your face has to be at the center of the screen. Thoda sa aap piche hoiye ya computer screen ko aage kariye. Matlab piche tak ke liye thoda. Just little adjustment, sir. Yeah, I think that's perfect. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Sorry for interruption.
So our focus is on scientific data, the presentation methods of our deadly friend, then how it is going to affect our patient case studies. Most importantly, our objective is in the center. We as a primary care physicians deal with all types of forms, all types of patients like this. This is going to be a healthy, unbiased, interactive discussion with very useful outputs, which will be appreciated after discussion. So, what are the tips for managing diabetes in current pandemic of 2019? Diabetes, we are all well aware, but this COVID-2019, we are not. How you identify this enemy? What is COVID-19? What is the epidemiology of current situation? How contagious is this disease? How fatal it is? What percentage of people need life support and they succumb? What are the clinical features? How to diagnose? And what are the social precautions? With concluding message on how diabetes affects this disease, or how this disease is affected by diabetes. This gentleman is a whistleblower, Dr. Lee Wellinang. The doctor chat group that he has noticed 7 cases of virus that he thought looked like, and it has got envelope, it has got genetic material, proteins, spikes look like round. That's why this virus is called as a coronavirus. It got affinity to the respiratory tract. So majority of the end organ damages start with respiratory tract. Then it involves cardiovascular system, and it is something called as a cytokine storm. There are hundreds of cases which are spread not only from China but all other countries almost all over the globe. That way it has been labeled as a pandemic. Some severe same cause severe diseases which we were recognized previously was SARS-CoV in 2003, MERS-CoV, that is Mediterranean, in 2012, and this is the current month. Mainly it has got crown-like spikes on the surface. There are four main subgroups of the virus. It has got a structure called as a papillomeric structure. It may explain the virulence of the virus, how it goes to the mucosal surfaces. There are four types of coronaviruses, first identified in mid-1960s. And there are seven COVs called a novel, but because it is a new virus, it is a mutated virus. On December 31, 2009, WHO was informed of an epidemic of pneumonia of unknown cause detected in a city called as Wuhan in the Hubei province of China. The second in China, around 11 residents Solapur. The first reported infected individuals, some of whom showed symptoms as early on December 8, were diagnosed to be among stallholders from the South China. On January 10, a gene sequencing further determined it to be the new Wuhan coronavirus, named a 2019 nCoV, a beta coronavirus, related to the family of Middle Eastern Respiratory Syndrome virus and the SARS virus. However, mortality and transmissibility of 2009 COV still unknown and likely to vary from case to case depending upon the area of the world where it is invited. It is invading. For example, in India, we are seeing less number of patients. The temperature of our summer. But it is surprising that Australia also is facing the same type of temperature, but the cases there are rising. Clinical symptoms, they are like any other viral infection. But what is most important, first it starts with a very high grade fever. The cough is normally not productive. Then there is a breathing difficulty. There may be few GI issues like vomiting, diarrhea. But the transmission is through the coughing or sneezing from infected person or touching mainly the contaminated surfaces. So it is the analysis of the patients who have presented and have been proved to have coronavirus infection. Fever, dry cough, fatigue, sputum, shortness of breath, muscle or joint pains, sore throat comes a bit late, almost 13-14%. Headache, fever, chills is less. Nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea may be another 5%. The sequence of symptoms, it is fever is the major, dry cough is the second. Fatigue and shortness of breath is third, and sputum production is fourth. Now, this kind of symptoms which we see in all common conditions, a common cold or a flu. But what is the difference? A common cold, the time between is 1 to 3 days. Flu also is a shorter duration. The symptoms in flu are abrupt. In corona, they are gradual. How much time takes to wane off? Corona takes almost 2 weeks and severe cases almost 6 weeks. Fever is a very common thing. Running nose is less common in corona. Sore throat is less common in corona. Cough is common in corona. Body is less common in corona. Remember the four major components: fever, cough, breathlessness, and a feeling of weakness, which is attributable to almost that the patient remains on bed and with a history of contact with somebody who has either traveled abroad or has been in contact with that person. How this disease is contagious? The contagiousness of any disease in epidemiological language is on average, how many people each infected person will in turn infect a fully susceptible population. So if you have got more R-naughts, it is more contagious. COVID has got more R0s and it is very contagious. How you compare it with other? 15, then COVID at level 3. SARS was at level 3. COVID at 2.8. Ebola was 2. And MERS was at 0.1. Seasonal influenza is 1.5. So it comes exactly in between the infectivity spectrum. What are the models of transmission? It spreads from contact to contaminated surface or objects, touching the subject, objects that has virus on it, and then touching the mouth, nose, and eyes. Suppose you have 100 patients which have been proved to have COVID is around 3.4%, seasonal flu is 0.1, SARS was around 10%, and MERS was around 34%. So the fatality was 3.4%. Now, what is our role as a primary care physician in management of outbreak of such a disease? We are all basic clinicians. We should evaluate the patient clinically. At the same time, the patient has proper protective equipments on our body. Check SpO2, PPR-BP, early diagnosis, including the throat examination with a torch distance from a long side. Check patient that they are diabetic or they are anemic or they are suffering from cancer or they have recovered from cancer. The contact tracing or contact inquiry, please get basic clinical signs, plot them, because the variation will help you whether the patient is deteriorating or not. Radiology is a good friend of clinician. Lung ultrasound, which is less commonly used, is a good investigation method. CT of chest, but taking the patient to the CT center and disinfecting the CT center is going to be a very mammoth task. We should also have a baseline ECG of the patient with QT interval calculated, because there are certain drugs which we give to these people who can cause increased QT interval and can cause more problem. There are cases reported with some of the newer investigational drug and interaction with drugs like azithromycin that patients have developed cardiac arrest and they have succumbed to it. What are the investigations? The first and foremost investigation is the RNA PCR, PCR by swab. Then let us go to our most friendly CBC. There is a very simple criteria called as a neutrophil to lymphocyte ratio. If it is around 3.13, it is definitely useful for diagnosis. ESR, CRP are the investigation which generally indicate the state of inflammation. LFTs, they hardly rise to more than 200 SGOT-SGPT. LDH is a good marker of inflammation. Serum creatinine, sodium, potassium tells you about the renal status as well as management of fluid. The cardiac injury markers and the cardiac congestive cardiac failure markers like D-dimer also has been said to be an important marker, but a serial evaluation of D-dimer is required and the test is not available with everybody. What else you can do as a primary care physician? This is a paper about knowledge, awareness, attitudes towards novel coronavirus. Among caregivers and patients of the outdoor patient sitting, a questionnaire-based survey in India. And this type of presentations, this type of surveys, they will help you in getting an academic edge over others. Another e-poster, which is a virtual e-poster, which is a conference of chest, which is postponed to 2021. The systematic review of ongoing trials evaluating the diagnostic and therapeutic interventions to manage the infection caused by 2019 coronavirus. It has been edited. The study has been done by Dr. Redkar from Sindhudurg, and it is a good number of physicians all over the track which has supported him in this paper. ARDS and multi-organ failure. The commonest multi-organ failure is respiratory. What is the time at which the patient gets these symptoms? It is acute, within 1 to 2 week symptoms. How we assess the hypoxemia of the patient? A very simple calculation. When the patient is on ventilator with a PEEP of more than 5 and his PaO2 divided by FiO2 is less than 300, this is the person who is likely to suffer from ARDS. Bilateral opacities in chest or CT or B lines on the lung, and most important, absence of the cardiac or alternative cause to explain all the symptoms. And in a complete clinical profile of subjects meeting criteria for the COVID, the better chances of recovery are there. The next point is how you diagnose. If the patient meets the testing criteria, he should undergo the SARS-CoV-2 test. Without touching the teeth or tongue, those people who can who have got samples of the lower respiratory tract like bronchoalveolar lavage, that is has got more positive, use personal protective equipment for specimen collection, droplet and contact. Please remember that the viral swabs, the sticks, they are very special sticks. They are, the swabs are made of either Dacron, the stick is also not made of wood, but it is a different kind of stick of plastic. So do not transport swabs which do not fit into the standard criteria of transportation. How you collect the swab? This is the way in which you can pick up, pack, and transport. Because transporting this swab is important. This is India's first transmission electronic microscopy image of novel coronavirus was released about 2 days back. All you can see the virus very clearly with all the plasmids and corona on its surface. Now, when a patient he has a condition called as SARI, that is acute respiratory infection with history of fever and lasts for around 10 days, requires hospitalization. Now, person with history of fever, cough, no other etiology. Clinician also should be alert of possibility of atypical presentation in an immunocompromised state. They may not have even fever. The disease occurring in a healthcare worker who has been working in an environment which patients with severe acute respiratory infections are cared for with this without regard to the place of residence or history of travel and any possibility of diagnosing COVID in that place, or the person who develops unusual, unexplained clinical course. But this sudden deterioration, despite appropriate treatment, without regard to the place of residence or history of travel, even of another etiology also has been identified, can explain the clinical presentation. And these are the guidelines from Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. And these are all available on web. You can download, print, and you can use them in your clinical practice. The first definition of SARI is a person with any degree of severity within 14 days of onset of illness, either with contact of confirmed case of COVID-19 associated COVID have been reported. These patients, these are called as a surveillance case. The first one was surveillance case for SARI this is close contact, including providing direct care to the COVID-19 patients, working with healthcare workers, visitors, staying in the same close environment, working together in the close proximity or sharing the same patients, any kind of community, living in the same household as COVID for COVID-19 patients with a possibility of close contact. The teaching study, there are three slides on this study. About 138 hospitalized patients with the NCV infected pneumonia. 56, majority were men. Hospital associated transmission was possible was 40%, and hospitalized person about 12%. As discussed, common symptoms, fever, fatigue, break off. What was the laboratory thing? Lymphopenia, count less than 0.8. Inadequate range, that was the range schedule, prolonged prothrombin time, and elevated LDH. It is a non-specific marker, but it was present in almost 40% of the patient. CT showed patchy shadows. They required antiviral therapy. 26% transferred to ICU. 61 had ARDS, 44 had arrhythmia, and 30 had shock. And the median time from first symptom to dyspnea was 5 days. In hospital admission was 7 days and ARDS was 8 days. So you must remember that person who is having fever and if he starts deteriorating after 5th, 6th, or 7th, 8th day, he is likely to have more and more complication and going to need hospitalization. As compared to the patients who were treated in ICU and not treated in ICU, where older people, they were having underlying comorbidities and the other symptoms were dyspnea as well as anorexia. Of the patients, 36 cases in the ICU, 11% received high flow oxygen therapy, 42 received non-invasive ventilation and 48 received invasive ventilation, out of which 4 were switched to extracorporeal membrane saturation, that is ECMO, or they required renal replacement therapy or dialysis. And as on about 1 month, 34% patients were discharged, 6 died, overall mortality was 4.3%, but many patients are still hospitalized. It is stated that presumed hospital transmission was suspected in 41 patients and 26% of the patients who received ICU care, and the mortality was 4.3% as compared to 3.1%.
Dr. Kulkarni, sir, sorry to stop.
Yes,
sir,
please.
Aapki sir audio, sir, that is not please. Audible, sir. So can you just come little bit okay. Nearer, sir? Yeah. Sorry, sir. Sorry for interruption, sir.
Yeah, I will. No. Actually, you should tell me. This is a very typical CT scan of a coronavirus infection patient, where you can see the basal involvement, which is marked in the red. This is a very typical of coronavirus infection in the ultrasound. Let us come from China, and let us imagine. Analyze a scenario of 1,000 patients where around 85% will develop immunity, clinically recover, mild to moderate, 850 patients will totally recover. Out of 150, ICU care will be required for 50 patients. High flow oxygen will be for about 10 patients, NIV for about 15 patients, and multi-organ failure, ECMO or dialysis for 5. If the bomb explodes, this kind of clinical presentation is required, that is expected, and the death rate may go even up to 15 to 20 per 1,000. That is quite a significant amount of death in considering the overcrowding of Indian population is concerned. there is a lot of hue and cry about a molecule called as a hydroxychloroquine. This molecule has showed faster viral elimination in patients with COVID-19 infection. But there are no evidence from trials regarding the use. Recently, recommended for healthcare workers directly involved in providing care to suspect or confirm COVID patients, and the dose is 400 milligram BD for day one, and then after 400 milligram once a week for 7 weeks. It is a total 7 weeks. And household of the confirmed COD patients, 400 milligram BD for day one, followed by 400 milligram once a week for 3 weeks. These schedules only should be followed, and there should not be given any odd dose, because that way it is quite a toxic molecule. And the mechanism is it gives what we use to treat amoebic hepatitis or amoebic liver abscesses. So there are many most important thing is we have to use our personal protective equipments, then social distancing. It is not necessary that you should use a stethoscope for every patient. You can, there are many clinical signs which tell you better information. Even you should learn about preventive measures and support to your staff also. For older people at the highest risk, so we have to take care of special care of such people when they visit home or elderly people. And we have to pay attention to the marginalized, the people socioeconomically in our routine practice. And as a trusted healthcare workers, it is our job to reassure that those with symptoms and high risk need close attention, and preventive measures are given to them. Preventive drugs are given to them. And if you suspect clinically that the person is deteriorating, please don't wait. Get a test done for such type of patient. What you are supposed to tell to the close contacts of the patients? Again, the four important thing: washing of your hands, using soap water if you don't have sanitizer of alcohol based, covering your nose and mouth with handkerchief tissue, avoiding mass gatherings, and throwing the used tissues into the closed bins. That is also very important. These are all Ministry of India guidelines. Some of the do's: do wash your hand, cover your nose and mouth, see a doctor if you feel unwell for your patients with multiple comorbidities, avoid gatherings, and throw used tissue in a closed bins immediately after use. There are certain things that if you have got a close contact with anyone and if you are experiencing cough and fever, don't touch. Touching your eyes, nose and mouth unnecessarily, and most important is spitting in public. That is a very typical Indian phenomenon. COVID can live on so many common surfaces: in air about 3 hours, copper 4 hours, cardboard boxes almost a day, stainless steel for 2 to 3 days, and polypropylene plastic for almost 3 to 4 days. So you have to take a proper precaution in cleaning that. This is the biggest Indian weapon, either a cough or a spit. And you can see that the material can go even as long as up to 2 meters for the infectivity is concerned. The mode of transmission is the infected person coughs, sneezes or talks, virus is released in respiratory secretion, droplets infect others, and the patients who are most contagious when they are symptomatic. So there may be so many symptomatic patients having mild fever, cough, breathlessness, roaming around in our society, and they are transmitting this disease. Let us not forget a very simple manner of hand hygiene. And which are the movements are required for hand hygiene? One is before patient contact. Then before any aseptic task, if you are putting a gel co, if you are doing a catheterization, after body fluid exposure risk, after patient contact, or after contact with patient's surroundings, you should wash the hand properly. And how we should wash the hand properly, that this is the 6 stages. Rub hands palm to palm, right palm over the left, palm to palm with fingers interlaced. Back of the fingers is the area which is neglected. Rotational rubbing of the left thumb clasp in the right palm and vice versa. And rotational rubbing backwards and forwards with clasped fingers, right hand in the left palm and vice versa. These all things are available on the website of Ministry of Government. When to wear a mask? Big question. Everybody need not wear a mask. Only wear if you have got symptoms, cough, fever, dyspnea. Are you caring for COVID patients? And if you are a health worker attending the patients with respiratory symptoms. There are many types of masks are available. There is a huge demand for N95 surgical masks. If you use for 6 to 8 hours, they are quite good. And right now for the doctors, there is a clear cut directives. While wearing a mask, make sure that am I audible?
Yeah, thoda audio quality poor hai. Maybe because of the internet connectivity. So I think you can move on because lights are being seen.
But doesn't matter, sir. I mean, this okay. is part of it.
I'll try to raise my voice also. While wearing a mask, make sure that you unfold the pleats of the mask that they are facing down. Change the mask after 6 to 8 hours as soon as, and avoid touching the mask while using it, especially the front part of. Do not touch the potentially contaminated outer surface of the mask while removing it. You have to remove it from the ear side only. Place the mask over your nose, mouth and chin and ensure that there are no gaps on either side of the mask. Adjust to fit and never reuse the disposable mask and dispose the used mask into closed bins after disinfecting them. Do not leave the mask hanging from the neck. After removal of mask, please clean your hands with soap, water or alcohol-based hand rub disinfectant. This is really very, very important because majority of the times we just take out the mask and start doing our regular clinical work. This is about sequence about how to put on the personal protective equipments. First is gown, second is the mask or respirator, third is goggles or the face shield, and last is a gloves. The most important weapon in our hands is social and physical distancing, which is most wanted. And this is the effect how if one person infects 2.5 patients, ultimately ending 406 people with less contact, it goes to 0.625 to 2.5 people. It is a very significant amount of reduced infectivity. But we Indians are very clever. We mark our backs and then start chit-chatting. That is not the right way of a physical distancing. These are the way in which how the metal surface and cardboards and other things, they behave as far as the viral structure is concerned. If you want to tell all your patients, social physical distancing is most important and most wanted. There are saral vicharayacha, tumhala kuthe rahayla avadel, gharamadhe rahayla are, hospitalmadhe rahayla, ka bhintivar photo jatay. He asa yuddha hai ki je gharat rahun suddha jinktay. There may be some rare side effects of social distancing. You go on overeating and you have got a problem ki 14 tarkhenantar darvajatna bahar kasa padaycha, and the jeans of the buttons of jeans also start showing the social distancing from each other. If you want to educate your children, there are some fantastic publications like this. It is a book called as a Kids Why You and Corona. It is a comic type book, and this will keep your children happy in your home when they are quarantined. Now friends, let us focus or shift our focus to a commonest Indian comorbidity, that is type 2 diabetes. Everybody knows that diabetes and COVID 2019 19 is not a good combination. It is a detrimental combination, especially in type 1 people who develop diabetic ketoacidosis, and type 2 patients who already have lot many other comorbidities like congestive cardiac failure, COPD, rheumatoid arthritis, chronic liver disease, chronic kidney disease, they suffer maximum. And what is the key? The key is control of sugar. Asking 100, PP 150 and HbA1c 6.5. So you please emphasize your patient that they should have a proper control of blood sugar and adjust the doses. Exercises has been shown to improve the immunity, and very important point that those diabetics who have taken influenza and pneumonia vaccinations, they remain protected from the complications and decrease chances of bacterial pneumonia and respiratory tract infection. So this is the paper which tells timely blood glucose management and why it is urgently needed. And it is reported that overall population of diabetes of COVID 2019 was from 5 to 15%, with an average of almost 10%. Timely glucose management is urgently needed, because you can, by proper control, you can prevent infection and comorbid diabetes associated with more ICU stay, prolonged ventilatory need for almost about 3 weeks as compared to about 4 to 5 days for the non-diabetic people. Compared with patients who did not receive ICU care, ICU patients with viral infection are more likely to have underlying diabetes, almost to the tune of 22% versus 6%. And largest epidemiological investigation in China indicated that mortality was 7.3%. It was dramatically higher than the patients who did not have any comorbidity, which was about 0.9%. Means there is an increased chance of 8 times more morbidity. So these are the chronic diseases which must take care: CVS, chronic respiratory diseases, hypertension, cancer, no pre-existing conditions, 0.1%, this is almost 10%. So corona deaths with underlying chronic conditions are more, and we have to take care of chronic condition including diabetes. Older patients are definitely at risk, 80+, 15% mortality, and 60 up to 70, 3.6% and up to 88% mortality. If you compare 30 to 39, it is about almost 0.2%. So older patients, metabolic disorders, it is not a very good combination. Uncontrolled diabetes triggers stress condition and increased secretion of hyperglycemic hormones like glucocorticoid. It increases the sugar, glucose variability, and presents the person more to the diabetic complications. Hospitalized patients need good glycemic control. Long-term follow-up is still essential for diabetic patients to reduce diabetes-related complications. Our patients must maintain a proper diabetes chart, fasting and PP, both morning, afternoon, and night, at least 2 readings once. Till date, online services and resources are playing remarkable role nationwide in COVID-19 controls, not only in China, but all over, where you have got access to internet and smartphone. You can properly keep the track of your blood sugar, and you can be in touch with your doctor so that he can adjust the dose of your anti-diabetic drugs or insulin. Now, let us consider the second part of it. What are the unproven therapies? There are a lot many unproven therapies. Till today, there is no proved evidence used like lopinavir, ritonavir, interferon, RNA polymerase inhibitor like remdesivir, and we just discussed about chloroquine, which is of a prophylactic use. It has been said that there is an antagonism between ACE2 and ARBs, but the European Society has cleared this issue and they don't want to stop you these drugs. Zinc nanoparticles were to have inhibitory effects on viral load to their effect, and still it is again an experimental drug. Another important aspect which was observed in Wuhan was medical workers in Wuhan had faced enormous pressure including high risk of infection, inadequate protection from contamination, overwork, frustration, discrimination, isolation, negative emotions, lack of contact with families. Severe situation causes many mental health problems, and they not only affect the medical workers' attention, understanding, and decision-making capacity, which might hinder the fight against this particular virus. So just to elaborate the complex problems, there can be just anxiety, depression, to panic or agoraphobia, a dread sense of uncertainty. People are obsessively washing their hands, paranoid ideas of cleanliness. People stay away from social rituals, unsafe homes, child abuse, and isolation-related emotional crisis. And nutritionally, they are either overeating or undereating, exposing them, creating them models of obesity or malnutrition. This is something which is really causing more and more problem, because we are almost 14 hours watching our television, and this is information overload syndrome. Dr. Sanjay Gupta is there in all the foreign international channels, and also Dr. Eric Topol. But this gentleman, who is always seen near the president, is Anthony Fauci. He also is the editor of Harrison's textbook of medicine. And the information given by them sometimes really puzzles us, that whether they are talking scientifically or under political pressure. So friends, let us come back again to our basic role of primary care physician. We just checked our clinical and laboratory role. And suppose if anybody of your patient, he goes bad, he has got an acute onset, he remains hypoxemic, bilateral opacities, and there is no cause to explain symptom and become breathless, and he goes to ICU. So what are treatment options? High flow nasal cannula. This is available even in our resource limited setting. Then you can use a non-invasive ventilator by using a CPAP or BiPAP. If required, this is another way in which helmet will help to as an interface to give the ventilation of a laser aerosolization. We talked about role of lung ultrasound in ARDS. You can get heterogeneous beta lines and lung sliding subpleural consolidations. Sensitivity is almost to the tune of 93% to 98%, and specificity to almost 80% to 100%. So this is a missed, not properly used investigation. We must use this investigation more often than the CT scan. Now, what is the role of corticosteroids? Corticosteroids, that low dose corticosteroid, that is shock reversal with no corticosteroid therapy, there is a weak recommendation, quality resistance, low quality evidence. But COVID-19 ARDS without shock, that using systematic steroids or not using using corticosteroids, it's a weak recommendation and low quality evidence. If clinicians are using steroids, if you want to use, they should use a lower dosing and shorter treatment course, that is around 200 milligram of hydrocortisone per day or over a period of 24 hours in an infusion. Again, for vasopressors, norepinephrine is the first choice. If not available, vasopressin or epinephrine. But with adults COVID-19 and shock, a strong against dopamine, if norepinephrine is available, it has got a strong recommendation and high quality evidence. Resuscitation with the fluids, shock and recommendation is using a conservative or liberal fluid therapy. Don't overhydrate the patient and use buffered or balanced crystallites over the unbalanced crystallites. You have to use a restrictive fluid strategy, and depending upon the patient's urine output, you have to use Lasix when you are treating furosemide, when you are treating a congestive cardiac failure or a fluid overload. You must monitor urine output and minimize fluid voluses and avoid positive balance. A daily weight may help in such types of situations. Again, hemodynamic support, if there is hemodynamic destabilization, shock is seen almost up to 35% patients and cardiac injury up to 23% patients. So use dynamic parameters, skin temperatures, capillary refill time or serum lactate or static parameters in order to assess fluid responsiveness. When you have multi-organ failure, you may require renal replacement therapy, dialysis, and this is one of the example of ECMO, that is extracorporeal membrane oxygenator, which gives a respiratory support. And this is a VV ECMO, and this is VA ECMO, which is gives a respiratory plus cardiac supports. Not many institutions are having this equipment, and this is quite again a costly. So friends, don't forget or ignore your diabetic patient. Monitor disease, use technology, use combination of oral hypoglycemic agents so that you can reduce the pill burden, identify the emergencies at earliest, investigate thoroughly with the help of laboratory and radiology, treat adequately, refer in time in and complications so that they have got a proper nice recovery without any residual damage. The last part of my presentation is a big question: how the epidemic may end. We all talk about flattening of the curve. We are expecting that India should go in this particular phase, but we are not going there. We are still stuck at this particular way. When we may face a situation, there is a forced medical rationing about the drugs, about the equipments, and about the PPEs. Developed countries like UK and Italy are already facing this problem. Let us hope that this peak in India comes still lower down and we don't face this particular problem. Again, you have to know that how contagious or what is the R0 value of this virus is there, and the effect of social isolation, and there are multiple views of people how the social distancing and how the lockdown will help for such types of epidemics. So at the end, in the words of the UN chief, that COVID-19 pandemic, most challenging crisis in World War II, more than 8.5 confirmed cases, US has got 1.84 lakhs with 4,000 deaths, India around 1,400 with around 35 deaths. So take home message for everybody is, we have to think globally, nationally, and act locally. We have to practice physical distancing. We have to track, test, and treat the cases and comorbidities like diabetes. Don't forget the asymptomatic, test them also. Stay at home, but remain active academically, like what we are doing with the help of PRECIA team. And as a proud nation, we can put forward a different model of health and pandemic care. In the words of William Osler, medicine is the science of uncertainty and the art of probability. And when you check these three words on Wikipedia or Google, you will come that soap and water and common sense are the best disinfectants. Thank you very much. And we will definitely like to take more and more questions. Again, there is no much better importance on physical distancing, most wanted. Try to stay fit, try to do regular exercise, take care of your nutrition so that you did not have this particular problem, and try to be in touch for getting any technical support from us. So at the end, thanks to all the precious support, what we did was did not touch the controversial issues, but also we focused on scientific data. If you've got any questions, these are my contact numbers and email ID, or you can be in touch with any PRECIA person who can solve our queries. And all the material which is required for our references, that will be available on the net.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Sir, we can take the questions right now. There are a few questions which has come in.
Yes.
You can stop the screen share so you would be able to see the audience.
Okay.
Yeah. I request the doctor,
yes,
and the attendees to please ask the question. Dr. Redkar had some very, very wonderful question in the mid of it. Dr. Redkar, can you?
Yeah, Dr. SV, can you listen me? I'm Dr. Redkar.
Yes, we are. Go ahead.
Hello, Dr. SV. Yeah, yeah. My question is whether
we all can listen to you.
Okay. My question is please, whether COVID is a sexually transmitted disease like
SARS epidemic.
No. Let me ask you a very common question asked by the people to us. A newly married couple usually ask whether COVID is a sexually transmitted disease like HIV or hepatitis B. Whether you can get viruses in semen. Whether COVID is a sexually transmitted disease like HIV or like hepatitis B.
No. Right now, there is nothing to say about it. It is only a contact and aerosol droplet transmitted disease. So, sexual transmission is not really known today. There is hardly any record.
Thank you.
I'm not screen off the things. So how I can?
Hello, can you listen to me?
Now I
quality audio.
Vivek, you had seen patients of SARS.
Sorry, I will ask
you. When it stopped, and you had written an article also that one patient of SARS in Goa has caused problems in 1 year for the tourism. What was that experience? Right. Can you?
I'll narrate that. One very important thing was that is wrongly been given by this all media. So media had made a havoc that time because SARS death rate was almost 10%. So it is far, far more than COVID. So even one patient there in Goa has almost stopped Goa tourism for 1 year. So in Mepicon, you are a secretary. In fact, you are a brain of our Maharashtra Association of Physicians for Mepicon that time. And we have taken a conference, media and medical field. How media should act in
your reaction from media.
No, it is
right now we are also suffering.
That's true. Second question I would like to ask you about the sex. You know, I would like to ask you whether it is sexually transmitted disease, you see, like HIV or like hepatitis B.
No. It is not like that. Unless you are using some different methods or different ways of it. Let us.
I got it. But it is not sexually transmitted disease. Semen has not been analyzed yet of any COVID patient.
I want to ask.
Hello.
Many of our physician friends.
I'll ask you one relevant question. Now, if any person who has hydroxychloroquine prophylaxis.
Dr. Redkar, go ahead. You are audible.
Now about hydroxychloroquine prophylaxis in diabetes, you are talking about hydroxychloroquine. Already we give it in diabetic patients. So whether there are any study went like that, and even 1100 patients which in USA they are trying hydroxychloroquine, whether diabetic patients were involved there, they are involved diabetic patient with hydroxychloroquine who are already on the hydroxychloroquine for diabetes. Any information you have about this 1100 patients which USA is trying hard?
I'll ask another thing. There are many patients. Vivek, I will answer this. There are many patients who are on hydroxychloroquine 4 milligram per day as a anti-inflammatory and action exactly which modifies the insulin resistance. But till now, there is not a single study which tells that the person who is taking hydroxychloroquine has remained immune or whatever study deaths we had. There is no drug history that the patient was either what combination of antidiabetic drug he was taking or whether he was taking hydroxychloroquine or not. It is still on an experimental stage. It is only the touch is going to tell whether it is going to be of any use.
No, whether you are going to get this logical thinking and solution that diabetic patients should be started with hydroxychloroquine because it is sugar also.
Yes, hello? there is a definite logical reason for that because it has got an action which is just like pioglitazone. So it modifies the insulin resistance.
Okay. I would like to ask you one more question. One more question just before I finish. Whether we can take serum of these patients who have already been suffering from COVID and they are totally recovered, whether their plasma can be transferred to the serious patient, because you will get ready-made antibodies. Is it possible?
Very intelligent.
This treatment is called as a convalescent plasma therapy, and there are only till now only 5 cases from Scandinavia. I have got certain relatives of mine who are in US, and one of them person is on ventilator, and they are trying for a convalescent patient serum
plasma,
but it is not available, and there are a lot of ethical issues associated with it.
Okay, that's
there are a lot of ethical issues. Okay. People may not share their plasmas that easily after the recovery from a deadly disease like COVID.
Okay.
Dr. Redkar, you have one paper presented on the subject. Yeah. Would you like to talk a bit about that?
No, already SV has talked on that, because I am not the only person. Dr. Wadhwa also has given a nice lecture on before COVID name and its COVID-19 name ceremony. He has given a nice lecture because a boat from China has came to Reddy. Reddy is a mine center, and mine workers and this a big ship has come from China. So I called Dr. Wadhwa, Dr. SV for that meeting to give guidance to our private practitioner what precautions they should take, because this is the first time ever in our in Maharashtra that some Chinese people, original Chinese people came.
Okay.
And they left 21 days back. So that time we were not knowing what is the period. I mean, whether it is incubation period is 14 days or whether it is 28 days. Now they have extended that period from 14 to 28 days. But I think if Wadhwa is in online, and even SV knows the things, and SV is one of the person who has helped me to write this paper with Dr. Wadhwa. So SV knows. SV, would you like to add something? Because you also mentioned that about that paper. And I think that paper and cases done by, research by Chinese people, there are some Chinese injection and plant injection, which they say it is useful. And I think that has been mentioned in the research papers. That research was up to January. That time, hydroxychloroquine was not taken, in the research papers. So there are a lot of papers now in last 1 month, because it is not something like multi-centered or placebo-based double-blind trial or something like that.
I'd like to add
very less paper are published.
Yes. I'd like to add here, in fact, this medical education program on coronavirus is brainchild of Dr. S V Kulkarni and Dr. Redkar. Dr. Redkar has been the pioneer, perhaps maybe in the country itself. That was the first meeting what Dr. Redkar had conducted live. So that was not a virtual meeting. That was not a lockdown era. That was no panic that time. That was actually in person meeting, because there was a social panic in around Reddy village, around the Reddy. Actually, a ship had come which had Chinese crew, but although the ship was on sale for more than three months, the Chinese people actually didn't go to China. But since they were Chinese, the scare was so high. So everyone from Redkar Hospital, Reddy, from Dr. Redkar, Dr. Mohan Jagtap, etc., had gone to it. And in fact, I have seen those videos. It is so scary even to, get into a ship through a boat, a lander lagging in the water. It looks very, very simple when we are talking.
That's right.
But yeah. Believe me, these are all very delicate, sensitive issues. So that's the reason, Dr. Redkar had organized a medical education program only on how to handle, how to screen, availability of kit. Dr. Redkar, the first one to talk about that. Then parallelly, this was on February 9th. At Sindhudurg district, and parallelly,
Dr. Wadhwa, it was SV's guidance also.
Yes, I'm coming to that. Then Dr. SV Kulkarni, parallelly been suggesting us, guiding us for research work, that we should document all those experiences. What is the treatment option? Now we are talking about
that those efforts are really very pioneering, as you said. And congratulations, Dr. Redker, for that. I heard about it, but today...
Hey, thank you, Sanjay. It is you given us opportunity, and we're really thankful to you keeping such a topic, and SV has presented it very nicely. Except for some audio and video disturbances, everything was excellent. I must congratulate Dr. SV and you for giving us a feast of such a type of knowledge. Yeah. And especially to the practitioners who are practicing all over.
In fact, I like to summarize that paper. That was a very innovative thing. 29th of January, that was the last date for submission of the paper to the World Chess Congress. So out of our own curiosity, there should be some treatment. A lot of news were coming. We were seeing some videos, Chinese people falling on the ground. These are all fake videos then. But now we realize they may be genuine actually. So what we did as a team, that we looked into the ongoing trials. There was none in WHO clinical trial registry database. There was none in clinical trial GOV. All the trials till 29th, we had seven trials. We evaluated seven trials which were registered. We don't have the outcomes yet, but seven trials, the protocols which were registered, evaluating various therapies. So, they have looked into antiretrovirals, ostalamavir, Chinese herbal medicine, IV ascorbic acid. So basically, look at the the science in such a panic, in such a pandemic, in such a tough scenario also, the evaluation of the protocols, ethics committee approval, everything is parallelly going on. It doesn't mean the life stops there. That was a big learning beyond the scientific element. And coincidentally, this meeting was supposed to happen in Italy in the month of June, which is now postponed to 2021. But still, everyone is responding from Italy. We have been getting from them. Parallelly, they are publishing it in the this one of the highest impact factor journal, chess journal. This has been taken to the highest level. Perhaps this must be one of the first research evidence which is coming through. At least, we should understand first that what are the ongoing possible options which may come through. Then the clinical treatments. Now we are seeing that US, as of yesterday, there are 1,100 patients who are on trial with chloroquine for the management of COVID. Now, there is a thin line, whether it is prophylaxis, whether it is treatment, what could be the outcome, how do we address the adverse effect. But I think it could not be a bad option, at least this is my gut feeling, because the molecular mechanisms, there are so many things favorable. But all said and done, until we get some positive results, it's very difficult to comment. Yeah.
Dr. Wadhwan, yesterday Dr. Tedros from WHO also has mentioned about the trial which you are saying, apart from the solidarity trial.
Yes.
We have one interesting question which has been asked by Dr. Suresh Jain. He wants to ask the question. Dr. Jain, why don't you ask the question?
Suresh, Paul.
Hello. First of all, I congratulate all of you who are the participants, especially Dr. S V Kulkarni. And just don't want to take much of our time. Just want to know, is there a role of immunoglobulin in this?
What is the role of
immunoglobulin
in COVID-19?
No, it is, nothing has been confirmed whether it is useful or not. But these are all sorts of experimental therapies.
Okay. But monoclonal antibodies trials are on, and US is doing very aggressively, and unlike China protocols,
yes.
US is more aggressive on that. But all said and done, we don't know really the answers. Maybe because of the extensive cytokine storm, that is the first disaster which happens, especially in the younger population. I have compared the data, the publication from the Spanish flu with respect to cytokine storm. So that is the basis for these trials, which have recruited these patients on these monoclonal antibodies and, IgGs for detection also, for treatment also. Both ways it may work actually.
Dr. Kulkarni, there is another question.
I'll clear the first question. There is a drug called tocilizumab,
yes,
which has been used, but it is very toxic. At the same time, it is very costly.
Yes.
So unless some trial reports come out of it about the efficacy and the class of patients for which it is to be used, there is no point in advocating immunoglobulins or any immunomodulators, all these monoclonal antibodies, for management of this disease. Please.
So, the question was quite nice.
Question
was nice, because why children are not dying? Only a single child died in China. Why children are not dying of corona?
there are lot many unanswered questions about this disease. There is
cytokine storm is not there in children. Cytokine storm is not there in children, or immunoglobulin therapy, immunoglobulins, what sir is asking, is not going on in child. Means immunoglobulin will be helpful.
Sir, there are few theories of explanation about it. There is some component in our day-to-day, in our immunoglobulins, which protect it. Second is the vaccination of BCG, which protects our children from such kind of viral diseases. Yes. And the cytokine storm is a bit rare in this particular age group.
That's true.
Next question.
Yes, sir. The question is asked by Dr. Virajkar. What is your stake of adding hydroxychloroquine in patient type 2 diabetes with SB1C more than 9 as prevention and or as anti-diabetic drugs?
No, this is something very tricky. You can use this as a patient as an anti-diabetic drug once a day if the patient has got signs of insulin resistance like nigricans, central obesity. And, you know, automatically it will act as a prophylactic also for the prevention of coronavirus infection. No restriction in using IQ if the patient is appropriate for that. Hydroxychloroquine, 400 milligram, OD. But there are a lot of patients who don't tolerate that dose.
Dr. Bidarkar, you have one more question. Why don't you ask your second question as well?
Dr. Yes.
Kuti and others are there. Dr. Bidarkar, please. Dr. Bidarkar, are you online?
Sir, just unmute your that one. Hello, yeah. Yes, sir.
Congratulations, Dr. Kulkarni, sir. Very good presentation.
Thank you.
I am talking about the role of D-dimer as a prognostic indicator in the COVID cases.
See, first of all, D-dimer is a very costly test and the reports come very late. But high D-dimer is a bad prognosis. High LDH is a bad prognosis. High neutrophil lymphocytic ratio is a bad prognosis. Old age is a bad prognosis. High beta pro-BNP is a bad prognosis. It is very important for all of us who are practicing in a primary care level that we should document the patient in a complete way. Normally, we just look at the symptom of the patient. We forget the comorbidity. No doubt, diabetes is one of them. But there are a lot of patients who are suffering from connective tissue disorders like rheumatoid arthritis, SLE. We should not reduce their dosage of steroids or their drugs which are disease modifying. Otherwise, they flare up with this condition and they land up into multiple problems, even asthmatics. This presentation I am going to make available online and you can use it as per your requirements. There are some few more slides that also will be added, given to you as an add-on so that you can use it for your local groups. Without any more questions?
Yeah, looking at the audience, there is no further question is there. So, any question? I feel, sir, this is over, sir.
What is the risk? Yeah. I prefer.
Yeah, doctor's discussion.
People have to unmute
to respond. Pain, pain, clinic Dr. Jain.
Sir, in Panvel, they have given us the circular. But essentially, we should run our
day to day OPD.
Yeah, audible. Yeah. He's audible. Go ahead, sir.
Any other doctor wants to contribute option?
Hello.
I think Prashant.
Yeah, Dr. Pralaj.
I'm from Sindhudurga.
Wow.
And here in municipal area, they have made it compulsory, made the CEO and the Nagaradhyaksha. Even one of some of our patients went to the collector asking for if you want us to continue the OPD at the risk of this thing, Corona, they should provide us the PP. But unfortunately, they are unable to provide because even in at government level, there is a scarcity of these instruments, PP and all that. At Nagarpalika level, I'm from Vengurla, and Vengurla is the cleanest city. They have a lot of budget. They are ready to provide us the PP, but they are not getting where come to get it. They want some addresses for this thing. And one thing I want to ask the SV is there anything like reusable PP?
Hello. I will answer this question. Prahlad, Dr. Manchekar, I will answer this question because I talked with Dr. Inam Pakluj. He says that he has got scarcity of PP, but he is reusing it by spraying sanitizers on it and keeping it for 12 hours. Now, when you use PP from morning to evening, take it out, spray some sanitizer on it, and keep it for 12 hours and use it next day. That's the idea which he is doing. I don't know whether it is logical, but I don't know whether it is scientifically proven.
I like to update on this. You know, this is from the US CDC and some other reports, because even in US, where N95 masks have been abundantly available, there was in fact a big press release yesterday that how to utilize, how there is a process what they have defined to reutilize this PP. For example, N95 masks, what they say, sanitization is one option what they have suggested because resources are constrained. Exception is if it gets soiled, you know, typically with respect to intensivists or the anesthetists who are doing the intubation, if there is a spillage of blood and all, then it has to be discarded there itself. So optimal usage of PP is globally recommended. Even there has been a report from UK also that, you know, they are managing reusing. I think this may not be a bad practice if it is not contaminated, if it is not soiled to a very greater degree. Also, US has also advocated, and in fact, they have different grade of materials for N95. What they say, if the material is very tough, you know, then it can be easily resanitized by different even heating mechanisms, what they have postulated now. I don't know whether it will work or not, but they have clearly mentioned that it depends on the grade of material, quality of material of the N95 mask and other things. But my humble request to the medical fraternity, you know, keep asking, keep demanding the PP. I think it's like putting soldiers without any guns, and one cannot fight a war with knife, as simple as that, as Dr. Redkar also pointed out. This is very important. If we don't ask, no one is going to provide us, as simple as that.
Srikant Patil also has one question. He raised the hand.
Hi, sir. I'm from Kopoli. Srikant, sir.
Yeah, Srikant, go ahead.
Sir, I have one question. How many percent chances are there to get reinfection when patient gets recovered from corona?
Dr. Kulkarni might be offline. He is just coming in, sir.
Dr. Redkar can
Dr.
answer.
Dr. Redkar, if you add, sir, some value on this.
I can also, you know, I'll refer to some of the publications which are coming through on that. Reports, actually. Especially from the Chinese provinces. In fact, the reason why they have relocked some of the provinces in China is for that reason that, you know, now what they are saying is one side of the spectrum is symptomatic, undetectable cases in the beginning, which actually are the potential spreaders of coronavirus. Other side of it, patients who have tested negative after 3 days of being asymptomatic in quarantine, after being sent home, you know, they have again tested positive. So reinfection is evolving. There are reports. See, this is the reason, because we don't know the actual true natural history of the disease. That's a challenge, because natural history of the disease is very difficult to evaluate in such a, you know, pandemic panic scenario. But there are reports that, you know, there is a chance of reinfection even after being tested. And that may be a function of the sensitivity and the specificity of the type of testing which is being done, whether it is PCR based, whether it is antibody based, Now Abbott is going to initiate in next 3-4 days in US on home based on spot. So basically there are a lot of issues which are unaddressed, but certainly yes, you know, this is a the extreme spectrum causing a big threat actually. Dr. Redkar sir, you know, you want to add something on?
No, I would like to add, you should do that test again, one thing. And another thing is whether which test has been come positive. If it is a spot test like what we are doing in the most of the towns now in future, has no meaning whatsoever. Because the quality of test is important, like yes. Your PP.
Yes.
So quality of test, even subclinical, the patient is subclinically suffering, he has no antibodies formed, he is likely to get reinfected again. So chances are less, comparatively chances are less than a normal individual who has not got infection. You have reinfection. That's the only thing which I can add. Chances of reinfections are less as compared to the person who has suffered.
Yes. Maybe because of in some innate immunity come.
But even incubation period we are not knowing.
Yes.
See, this is the first time ever we are thinking that is 14 days. But incubation period has gone about 28 days. Some people are feeling that as scientific report came, even it is little bit airborne. Little bit means almost 6 hours. It can be an airborne disease also. I don't know whether that thing which is moving on WhatsApp university is correct or not. That it is going to be airborne also in some strains. Well, is it right?
Actually, you know what is happening as far as scientific literature is concerned. What is happening? Most of the publications are not peer reviewed right now because it will not happen. So you know there'll be. I'm sure down the line some articles will be retracted also in some of the journals. What we are talking now. There'll be some more addition because who is going to review in such a panic scenario? Number one. Number two, whatever is being documented from the source data has to be believed in an emergency situation because this will evolve. That's this true. Will keep evolving and it's evolving rapidly.
That's right.
Yes. Prashant, are you there online? Prashant Kulkarni is there online.
Yes, he is there. He's getting connected. Yeah.
Okay. I think we have lost the connection with Dr. S V Kulkarni. But I must say that this is the fifth meeting on the inside on COVID-19 and diabetes.
My voice is clear.
And this is the meeting where
yes, sir,
happened. Dr. S V Kulkarni.
My voice is clear.
I take this opportunity to express my sincere gratitude to Dr. Kulkarni. To agreeing to become the host of today's meeting, the main speaker. Dr. Vivek Redkar has really added a lot of, you know, scientific angles to this discussion with his questions and the many answers given. I also take up this opportunity to thank all the audience and the wonderful doctors across to really come and join this very important deliberation. And if there are no other deliberations to make, with the permission of Dr. Redkar and Dr. Kulkarni, I would like to close the session. Dr. Kulkarni, would you like to say the last word, please? I think we again lost the connection.
Yeah.
I think we all also have to look at the internet or broadband availability everywhere. Thank you very much, audiences. Thank you very much, Dr. Redkar. Thank you very much, everyone, for joining this deliberation. Thank you, Dr. Navneet Wadhwa, for supporting such a beautifully with the updated articles. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.